Sick, that's sick.
Sound effects like, provided like by AB.
That there should just for some reason be in all of our things now.
It's the new thing. It's the new thing that we're doing.
We should have done it last time. It's like love themes. What? Hello everyone and welcome to the Mack Flash 5, the show where we like to get together and list our top 5 movies fitting a certain topic. Today's episode is going to be a little bit different, though, because we're not really talking about the movies proper, but rather needle drops in the movies. Now, this is going to be part one of two-part music series involving movies. I think we're going to do something about soundtracks in our next episode.
This is the Mack Flash mixtape, right?
Yes. Volume one. Volume
one.
Or A side.
Yeah.
B-side. Oh, I like that. A side, B side. Like that's good.
I saw a joke or a meme today, and it was talking about how, of course, like tapes and albums had an A side and B side. So naturally, the next media would be C and D or CD.
Oh, CD. I like that.
It's actually great.
Cool. Blew my mind.
So let's introduce ourselves. I'm Matt. Scott is
up.
I get it wrong every time. Scott. Mixmaster Mike, that might be trademark. We might get an AB down below. AB is.
I'm not claiming to be anyone else. Oh. Just I can type words.
I see. AB picked this topic, needle drops, and you're going to start right because you picked the topic.
Yep.
How the show works is after we pick a topic, we go our separate ways, and we come back with our top five of the topic. AB, explain to us what a needle drop is.
Okay, so a needle drop is when a director takes a already pre-recorded song, usually like a pop song or a rock song, and inserts it into a film instead of the score. And the score is the orchestra music that's playing, that usually plays, that's made for the movie, usually plays in the movie. But this is an actual song that is usually already known song. We kind of are flexible for our rules. So there could be some songs that are written for the movie, but they're songs that you would hear on the radio. Yeah. Or songs that are,
popular before or even
popular before
or popular after
afterwards. Before. Yeah. So that's kind of what a needle drop thing is. And so for me, this is something I think about a lot. Obviously, as a music guy, music plays a huge part in how I love movies. And so when I was thinking about this, I had already had a set. At least one or two that I was like, okay, those are the ones I'm putting on. And my number one is forever be my number one. So that was a thing. But then, I started thinking about, oh, what about this one? What about this one? What about this one? And then the list became like a mile long. And so I started putting criteria in for myself. And so for my top three, I picked songs that I love the movie, I love the song, and I love both of them. So I can listen to the song outside of the movie, and I can listen to the song in the movie, and I love it. And then my four and five are kind of, fun ones. Four and five, too, also, I had not heard the song before I saw the movie. So the first time I heard the song was in the movie, so that's kind of what I did for my four and five. And they're a little more fun ones, and so I wanted to start us off with a bang, and so
while you're queuing it up there, it should be said that we're doing this a little different, right? We're going right. 5-4-3-2-1 instead of we're going to
normally we do 3 and 2 honorable mentions. This time will be all 5.
Yeah. Five, and so songs, just so everybody knows, this isn't Andrew's number 3. It's his number 5.
Yeah, this is my number 5, and I wanted to start us off with a bang. Mike knows what it is.
Send more. Send more paramedics.
So
for everyone else, tell us what this is.
All right, I will afterwards.
This does not sound like Thriller.
I never would have picked like this to be on the list. I love it.
I knew you would love it. I knew you would be all about it. All right, that's all I need from that. All right,
party time. Party time.
So that is from 1985, directed by Dan O'Bannon. That is Return of the Living Dead, and the song is by 45 Grave, and it's called Party Time. So that is literally that is a song that it is impossible for that movie to be referenced and me not automatically in my brain think, do you want a party? It's party time. Like, it's impossible. It is impossible. Time. Like, Return of the Dead comes up in conversation with whatever. It's funny. A friend of the show, Sean, they used to do like snot trivia and stuff with Francois. He loves this movie too. He would make reference to this. Like, we would talk about this movie and be like, do you want a party? Hey, it's party time. And it's forever intertwined for me that song in this movie. And like two, also it works perfectly because in that scene, there's these punk rock kids that are going to the cemetery to party after work. And they're looking to have some fun. And little do they know they're going to walk into zombie time and zombies are going to have
Where in the movie does that scene take place? The first?
It's about maybe halfway. Maybe like not quite halfway.
Yeah.
But,
you know, it's funny. And I know, Andrew, you know this, obviously, but it's funny because that movie has the fame of talk. Like, it's like, I think maybe the first talking zombies, like,
yeah.
So in that movie, there's, and I was alluding to it earlier, that one of the zombies gets on the radio in like an ambulance and he send more paramedics,
which is a reference to Mike. Well, it's also a reference that your Instagram is a reference to that.
Yeah, yeah. And it's a band now. Well, I don't know if they're still a band, but they're a British band that were so inspired by that hilarious moment that they actually recorded some albums. One which is like a full soundtrack of like what would be a zombie soundtrack, and then their own sort of like punk sort of styling. But it's just funny that, you know, a band came out of that movie, if you will, too. So.
Totally.
Man, cool. Never would have guessed. Never.
I knew you'd be jazzed too. I knew, and like, it's funny because you saw it as soon as it came up. You saw the photo and you knew what it was, and it's so funny. I knew you would love it. So I was like, that's why I said we're gonna have some fun right off the hop. We're gonna have a little fun because it's party time, guys. It's party time.
I should have been looking through all my zombie films to pick songs.
Well, I think you might have one.
Maybe.
Oh, yeah.
For my list, I went with the... okay, I get them confused all the time. Diegetic. Right? Where the music is visibly coming from something in the movie.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Usually in terms of music, a stereo or a car radio, or
okay, I see. Like the characters like hearing it as well.
That's what I thought too. Like if it exists, that's what I think I asked like a month ago when we came up with this topic. Sorry to say, I think I was like AB, I'm like, does it have to exist in the context of like society during the scene? So that's cool. I'm glad that you.
I think we came to the conclusion that it doesn't need to.
No.
It doesn't. We didn't put any stipulations on it.
Cool twist, right. Though. I like it.
No,
I like it.
But for me, when I think of needle drop, I usually think of a literal, you know, needle drop, not in the sense of my first one exactly, but you know, the record spinning, you put the, like Scott behind Scott, put the needle down, the music is playing and maybe it's at a house party and everyone's dancing to it. Mm-hmm. But mine is a little bit more melancholy for my first one. My number five is from it's from Say Anything, the classic scene.
Yeah.
Awesome
song. Peter Gabriel's In Your Eyes. We got John Cusack outside holding the boombox up.
The Dobler, Lloyd Dobler.
Lloyd, yes, right. Originally, the song was scored with Fishbone's Queen. Let me see, Queen of Life.
Fishbone?
Yeah.
Really?
What?
Yeah, interesting. That, I did not know that.
He's holding that up and nothing's really playing. This music gets added later. Peter Gabriel thought he didn't okay the use of In Your Eyes because he thought it was going to be used for a John Belushi movie. He's like, no, I don't want to do that. And they showed him the clip and he's like, oh, okay, go ahead. This is my number five because while the song is great, the scene is more like the iconic imagery. Because I was thinking the character holding up a boombox has been used so many times in so many other movies and TV shows, but they're always playing different songs. So it's not necessarily the song that's iconic, it's that image. So while the song is great, this becomes my number five because it's not the part that people really remember about it. It's really John Cusack holding up the boombox.
Don't you want to be the song though, eh? Like, you know how you said he said no to a different film, but like to be the song that he's holding up in that moment is pretty like powerful.
Right.
Yeah. That's Cameron Crowe.
Yep.
And so he's one of, I was going to say too, in my intro, and I completely forgot that there's the directors that you think of when you think of people that do needle drop things. And Scorsese was one of the big early ones. And then you have new ones, obviously like Quentin Tarantino,
Edgar Wright,
Cameron Crowe, and even like Fincher does it too. But Cameron Crowe is like a super musical guy. So he's got a ton in all of his movies, but that's a great one. I love that song.
Nice.
Cool.
Let's spin that record, Scott.
Okay, I'm going to try. I'm going to go through here on my number five. So it's funny. You made me think about if these songs do exist in the film as it's going. And I was like, oh, well, certainly my number five does. My number five plays a central plot to the film. The reason why I pick it is not only is it an incredible scene, you'll see in a sec, but it comes to the climax of the film. It's a big action set piece. And if you were a big fan of this franchise, you knew that it was a callback to the first film. And I'm talking about
Something's gonna blow up.
Yeah. Something's gonna blow up.
Hit me with it, Chris Pine. Let's make some noise.
Oh.
Star Trek Beyond.
That's a good choice.
And they find, so in this, Poppy in the theater.
So you're saying you like the use here instead of the first movie?
Pardon me?
You're saying you like its use in this movie rather than the first one?
So it's used. So what I'll say, I'll show that much there. So to give context to the scene, it's used in the first film when James Kirk is a young boy and he steals his stepdad's car and he's listening to Beastie Boys' Sabotage, which is awesome too, because if you know the context of J.J. Abrams, is a massive Beastie Boys fan. It's the reason why BB-8 is named BB-8 for the eight albums that the Beastie Boys have released. And that being said, you see this. So in the third movie, Star Trek Beyond, which I think is great. It's probably my second favorite of them. In it, they have the ships. They don't respond to loud music. So that's what they realize as the movie goes on. They're starting to destroy the city. And they realize that if they have a loud vibration, they all explode. So the girl soups up. They put the sound on the outside of the speakers. And that's exactly where, when you get Chris Pine saying, let's make some noise, subsequently leading to Sabotage being played through. Nice choice is a callback. And then again, what's fun is the meta double secondary part of, listen, all y'all, it's a sabotage. They are sabotaging the ships. Mm-hmm. And in doing so, what they do is they pipe it through to the city. It's just an awesome cut action scene with a ton of explosions for it too. So for the callback to the first movie, for the fact that it creates a really cool Star Trek scene and uses a really cool song, probably one of the few Beastie Boys that I actually like really got into. But so my number five is from Star Trek Beyond's Sabotage by the Beastie Boys.
It's used really well in the in the third movie because it's in an action scene. Yes. And if anyone who saw the Sabotage music video sees it's they're parodying an action movie.
Yeah.
So all of the fast cuts and the ships flying by and explosions really do fit the song.
That's awesome.
I mean, I like that choice because I haven't seen that Star Trek, that one. And so, but identifiable, the song, obviously, very identifiable.
Star Trek, yeah, it's fun. It's a harmless, like, action movie. It's the third one. Franchise had kind of weathered a little bit.
Yeah.
Obviously, Star Wars became more popular in its comeback, and then Guardians kind of stole a lot of their thunder. But go your way, see Beyond. Beyond is a fun little romp. And again, like I said, because the fact that the song's used...
And the joke in the first movie is that when Kirk flips the radio on, you see it's the classic. Station, it says classical.
Okay, I was going to say that when I said it, and I'm like, I don't know if that was right or not. So
yeah, it is.
Yeah.
That's funny. Okay. So I'm going to do a little twist here. I'm going to let the song and the clip speak for themselves, and a little twist here for the audience at home, all hundreds of you watching. What I'm going to do here is, I'm not originally going to play the video clip yet. I'm going to play a little snippet of the actual song, the part that would be from the thing. And I've asked these gentlemen here, and you at home can do this. I want you to try and do identify a few things for me. And I'm having you gentlemen write them down so that the people at home get a few seconds to guess before you just like, yeah, I don't want you to just say it, you know. So I'm going to play a little bit of the clip, not too much, because we'll obviously watch it. And you have to... obviously the easier part would be maybe naming the band or the song, but also if you think you know what film it's from. So if I picked good ones, they should be pretty identifiable, but there might be some twists and
turns. So you want band, song, and film.
Yeah, like kind of like a three-pointer, if you will. Right?
that's how we play music questions in the Mack Flash.
Yeah, trivia. If you want Grandpa year.
Wants the song. We're yeah, like,
if you
no,
want to do album, song, band, you want to do album yeah. year, like, I mean, you can.
Record label. But, I mean, mixing engineer credit
producers. And then you write them down, and then that gives everybody at home a chance to go, oh yeah, okay, I do know this, and they can sort of say it to their whoever that they're with, and then we'll reveal. Okay, so I won't explain that every time, obviously. I'm just gonna switch over sound here just so you can hear it
for people watching, and this is not the quickie that will come later today.
That is accurate. Okay, here we go. Okay, I'm gonna turn it up a little.
2 seconds in.
You can hear it, of course. You can hear it, yeah. Yeah. I won't play too much.
I know. I don't know. It's on every list, and I'm like, who is the artist? I'm not a music guy, so.
All right, so I'm going to stop it. Okay, just switch my sound back. Okay, so I'll give you a few seconds there, and then as you guys can kind of reveal, and then I'll get the actual clip sort of set up right after. All right, so you think you're ready there, guys? You can reveal those. I mean, this isn't got to be too whatever. So let's see. All right, we got Scott saying Fight Club, Matt saying Fight Club, Andrew, Fight Club, and then Where Is My Mind we've got there. Oh, this is funny. Good. And then we got Pixie. So between all
three. I was like, is that
Andrew's
it?
Got all three, of course.
Yeah, of course.
Of course I do.
I should have known, yeah.
So let's actually experience the actual moment and why this is sort of so powerful. This is my number five. This is the one that Scott predicted when I said mine are going to be doom and gloom.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So here we go. Sound good?
Yep.
Okay. Yes, but it's okay.
I love that line.
Yeah, it's amazing.
All right, we'll stop it there. That one just resonates with me because it's, I mean, that, it, for those of you who, I mean, haven't, most people have seen this, but that is like right before end credits. That is like leads into end credits, and it's essentially just like the song coming in just wraps it all up right in that moment that he has there. And it's just so powerful because you don't really expect it in everything that happens. And then it just cuts. And for me, I just, that one sticks with me. And that's, that song right there is what sort of made me go, okay, you know what? I like me the Pixies, you know? And so, and like, you know, I think Andrew kind of said, if that has that power, then to bring me to a band kind of, then I think that's a pretty good needle drop. So that one was like my first boom thought of it. So.
But it's funny too, because when you think, people think of that song, right? And they know the song and they know the thing and they know the song and they know the band because of that movie, right?
Yeah.
The Pixies were not a big band. They're not, they were not a big, you probably know, you could probably know, you probably know one. There's one in 500 Days of Summer.
Yeah, anyway, you've heard it, but can't name it.
Which almost made my list too. There's a really good needle drop in that movie.
Anyway, like the Pixies were not a big band in the 90s. They were, you know, a very indie band, and not a big, you know, thing. But after that movie came out, you would think that everyone, they were a household name for a lot of people. Like, oh, the Pixies, right? Mm-hmm. And we're like, and then they cut. I won't say that they blew up, but they got a lot more popular.
Of course,
pun intended. They blew up. I just think, and I think to be a band where, like, if you're asked to be in a movie, oh, that's awesome. But if you're in this pinnacle moment where he's basically destroying all of the buildings, like for the credit companies and everything, and this big huge moment that's all building to, and your song plays, that's huge. Like, I would be goosebumping out if that was my band. I'm watching this movie. I'm like, that's what they're using it for. Like, you know, I would love it. That's what I think of when I watch. Like, what's the band thing?
Yeah, sure. It's funny. I can, like, honestly, I can vividly remember being in the theater and that song starting up, and I got goosebumps because I love the Pixies. Yeah, and it was like, that song comes up, and I was like, holy crap, this is amazing.
I think the main thing is, somebody who doesn't like the Pixies or no, I think the fact that the song's called "Where's My Mind" in Fight Club
done. All the lyrics fit into it so well.
That's just Fincher, who, again, as we talked about, he does great needle drops in this and Zodiac. And
that's funny. I didn't even think about that. You guys were
that's the first thing. Every time I saw it, I was like, "That's great."
That's awesome
for sure. All right, we're going on to my number four. So my number four is a song that when I hear now, it sends shivers down my spine because of a psycho in the movie. I'm not thinking. It's not that one. Oh, it's not that one.
This movie is insane.
Dreams, I talk to you. In dreams, you're mine.
Gonna run a little bit longer just for this thing where
just keep watching it.
Gotta get that blue velvet on his face, because this movie is called Blue Velvet and it's from 1986 and it is by my man. Oh yeah, we'll get that lady, they're dancing on top of the car. Okay, and so, like I said, that's Blue Velvet from 1986, directed by David Lynch, and the song is Roy Orbison in Dreams, and Dennis Hopper there is playing one of the craziest, most psychopathic characters of all time, Frank Booth, and he loves that song, even though he doesn't know the name of the song because he calls it Candy Colored Clown. That's what he refers to it as. He gets... Dean Stockwell to sing it earlier in the movie, lip sync to it earlier. And as he's huffing nitrous and losing his mind. And so, yeah, that song, and I don't, it doesn't get a lot of radio play, but it has got radio play. And again, I hear that song and I hear that the opening line, Candy Colored Clown, and I'm just like, oh my god, Frank Booth. I'm looking around for Frank Booth. You're gonna come over and like,
Baby Wants the Fuck. Is that it? Yeah, weirdest thing I've ever seen. I watched that movie in high school. It's like, this is really weird.
It's pretty insane. And so, yeah, that's That's one of the wings. Again, I'd never heard that. I hadn't heard that song before the movie, and I'm a big Lynch guy. So when that played, I was just like, okay, I love this song. And yeah, it took on this a whole other meaning. Obviously took on a whole other meaning to, and I guess Roy Orbison was very against them using the song in the movie until he saw the royalty check start pouring sure, in.
Yep.
And all of a sudden, I like it. I like it. And yeah. I think he saw the movie too and like realized like how good the movie is. So yeah, that's In Dreams from Blue Velvet. She wore cool. blue.
Interesting selection.
I also wanted to do that. I also did that one for the fake out too. The Silence of the Lambs.
Just so you can say Psycho.
Oh, that's funny. Okay. We mentioned other directors who use music. Needle drop moments in their movies. I think, and Scorsese was brought up, and I can't remember the earliest form of his where he did it, but I can't be too sure if it doesn't outdate my number four. Here we have Wolfman Jack. Now the song playing, Why Do Fools Fall in Love by Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers. This is used in American Graffiti. Now, I'm only using this one song as an example, but the entire soundtrack is needle drops, with the exception of like three songs you see in a high school band. A high school band is playing at a dance. All of the songs are used through like the car stereos. It's essentially a musical. That's how George Lucas wanted to sell the movie. It's a musical, and people are like, I don't want to do a musical. No, but all of the music is through the car radios. And when the music isn't playing, you get Wolfman Jack, the DJ, doing like funny skits and stuff. And I just wanted to use that example, but read a passage from, I recently read the George Lucas biography. So of course it goes into detail about how he made all of his movies, and especially American Graffiti. And it's written by Brian J. Jones. And I just want to read what he wrote. It was the first time a pop soundtrack had been given its own dramatic presence in a film, an innovation that filmmakers like Quentin Tarantino and Joel and Ethan Coen would embrace as they practically built films like Pulp Fiction and Oh Brother, Where Art Thou around carefully selected songs from established pop and folk songbooks. In his desire to turn his soundtrack into a sound effect, Lucas had made the soundtrack and the soundtrack album a vital part of the movie experience. Essentially awesome. Saying he's the first one to do it. Now, that was kind of a cheat because I'm essentially talking about the entire soundtrack, but the example there was Why Do Fools Fall in Love by Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers.
I like it.
That's awesome. That's a great movie. As far as like, you're absolutely right. That whole movie is like a love letter to like music and cars. And it's a shame we never got that Lucas again. There was like interesting articles that's like, it's sad that Lucas never was able to replicate that, or how he felt at that time or whatever. Of course. And like in other films, just like we never got like an 80s like introspect, like, you know, George Lucas could never have given us like Wall Street or something. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But it is great that we had that little microcosm of like a youthful George Lucas, which again created like this James Dean style movie that'll live forever. So
it's set in 1962, and it's essentially about these four best friends. It's like their last night together before they all split off and go to college or various other things. So the entire soundtrack is from the mid 50s to the very early 60s.
Yeah, cool.
It makes me think of Link Letter too, with like Daisy Confused, right?
Yeah.
I mean, like, so like he does a very similar thing where you have, and I know that Link Letter and a couple of the other ones, they wanted to get not what we think of music from the 70s, right? It was like he wanted to get stuff that these kids would be listening to. And well, I think George Lucas is the same way, is like, what was playing, what would these kids be playing on the radios? Not like our definition of the 50s, right? It would be, and I think our definition of the 50s now is from movies, right? We get our idea of what the 50s look and sound like from these movies rather than like something else, like history books or, you know, from TV. Writer.
And, I think he made a list of like 40 songs he wanted to use and figured out that to do it the right way, you'd have to get the original artist, you know, singing, because the studios were like, well, you can get covers and just play the covers. No, I want what I heard when I was cruising the streets of Modesto.
Cool.
So he figured he would need like at least $100,000 to clear all the music. The budget for the movie was $750,000. $100,000 of that was just music use.
It's worth it. I mean, worth it. It's I've heard the same similar thing for Days and Confused soundtrack, and same thing. Linklater's like, spend it because like put in that music, right? That music makes that that music makes that movie, right? And it's the same thing with American Graffiti. If you just put on some cover versions of songs, that movie is a fraction of what it should be. So
solid.
Yeah, it's great.
Cool.
I want you to read from passages of books every
time. Sure. I'll do it. What's next? Soundtracks? I'll just read that same one.
You just read the inside, take the CDs out and read like
liner notes, the liner notes.
And then that.
That's great.
Okay, so I want to get to my four here, obviously. So it's funny that you bring up American Graffiti again, because you kind of reminded me of my number four film and the fact that it's not a good film. It's not a good film. And it's all needle drops to the point of excessiveness. And by the time the fifth needle drop hit in the first 20 minutes, I was like, this is awful. But then the sixth needle drop was able to mash up my favorite actor and my favorite musician in one film scene. And I have never in a theater gone from this to ever. And what I'm talking about.
I thought he was. Okay.
Y'all jokers must be crazy. So in 2016, Suicide Squad gave us Will Smith shooting guns to Kanye West's black skinhead. my leather black jeans on. Pardon, I'm getting my scream on. And that's not to say how awesome he looks firing these guns. But the fact that he's Deadshot and every single bullet is going in the exact area. Brilliant.
I have to say, I have not seen this.
Oh,
thank you.
And I thought you were going to be naming, because you're like my favorite singer, my favorite actor. I'm like, well, they're the same person. They're Will Smith. Any Will Smith movie?
They don't use, that is exactly, but like, they don't use Men in Black, or he didn't do a Pursuit of Happiness song, which featuring Jaden, I would have been all in on.
Which talking about Will Smith is something I love about him in his movies. Like, he'll add a song for the soundtrack for like the credits or something, but he doesn't sing in the movie.
Yeah, I know. Like Wild Wild West doesn't show up in Wild Wild West. It's like the end credits, but what we will get to though. Like I said, needle drop. So cool. I've watched this movie one time. I will never watch this movie a second time. I have watched this scene probably 200 times. I'm not lying to you. I have said, y'all jokers must be crazy every time I've held a fake gun or toy gun or just pretend. This is the definition of a needle drop. You took a scene and added music that David Ayer said, hey, Scott Despens, do you like Will Smith? And I go, love him. Do you like Kanye West? Love him. I'm going to give you one scene with both of them together, and Will Smith is going to fire guns to black skinhead. And I'll say, that sounds salvageable. And I enjoy it. So as far as the needle drop, that is awesome. That's an awesome scene to me. The rest of 3-1 for me have a little bit more like depth and like mean more. This is just a cool popcorn where I can be like, guys, it's black skinhead is in a movie. So number four, Suicide Squad's black skinhead.
I saw I saw that movie once, maybe twice, but you showing me that clip there, I want to see not necessarily Will Smith versus Keanu Reeves. I don't like Deadshot versus John Wick, because those two guys could fire guns. Like, I mean, you just saw there. I do want, yeah, I guess I want to see like a spy versus spy. Will Smith versus Keanu Reeves.
They're all about the headshots in both those movies. So you can get the first headshot.
But spy versus spy, like Mad TV spy versus spy? Like,
with bombs.
Yes, like slapstick? Yes. Spy versus spy based on the Mad TV comic strip directed by Michael Bay.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh.
Wow.
I can take that. Cool.
It's just all explosions. Okay. Get those whiteboards ready, Jets.
Yeah.
All right, get this volume here. Here we go.
I didn't include it because I knew it would be on yours.
All right, I won't play too much of that because I'm gonna show you a hefty chunk. When we comes to the actual clip, because it works so well. Speaking of Edgar Wright and music to scenes, but let's see what you gents got. I mean, this is the one I figured full with visual. I'll take that. Okay. Yeah. It looks like a clean sweep there, gents. Let me just share what we got going on. And like I said, I'm going to show a full chunk of this clip because of how perfectly
deserves
how perfectly Edgar Wright puts this to music, and this is a good example too, where they reference the fact that it's on because it's going on the jukebox.
The jukebox, yeah,
and he turn off the Queen, right? You know, so but here we go.
They kill the Queen, he says.
Yeah.
The thing I love about Edgar Wright too is that he does things to the beat. Like hits are to the beat. Yeah. Everything is on beat.
Yeah. He took the needle drop and
you really see that in Baby Driver. He really in Baby Driver
is crazy.
They like go out of your way to show that. Yeah. But you're right. He's always done it subtly in this. And then in Baby Driver, it's almost like he's like, man, no one notices I do
he's
that.
He's showing off.
Right here, and the light switches. This I had to do this. This is amazing.
Yeah.
Like, oh man, it's goddamn so good. Scene. Yeah, that's the thing. Edgar Wright took what everyone else has done and upped the ante on it.
Yeah. There's a little more.
That's so good.
So good.
Why is Queen still on? We've got a bit of a problem. Yeah, I noticed. Matt. Yeah,
no, I was just gonna say, to use Queen in your movie, you can never go wrong.
Oh, absolutely.
100%.
I feel that's foreshadowing.
No, really.
and you know, it's no secret that we kind of come up with our topics well in advance of filming different ones, and so we knew this topic, you know, a long time ago when Andrew had proposed it. And in the meantime, I had actually rewatched this film for another list, and then I was like, okay, what are my needle drops going to be? Like, I was a little worried, and then that happened, and I'm like, well, that's making this one as well as that one because it's too perfect.
Yeah,
right? I like they're moving to it, and like
it's really good. I feel like I just watched it too, but you're right. Dawn from The Office, when she, they're like, I feel like I missed that.
Yeah.
That's really good.
When this topic was initially brought up, needle drops, I was like, oh, well, it's Shaun of the Dead. And then a few weeks ago, we were talking about it deeper, and you essentially said you were going to put this in your list. I was like, good,
because
then I don't have to. I don't want to double up. I'm so glad it's going to appear, because it would essentially have been 3-1 on my list.
Sure. And you know what's interesting about it? Like, I mean, Queen obviously hits after hits, but no pun intended. But this song isn't necessarily one of my top Queen songs. But the more I watch it with that scene, the more it creeps up my list because I just like I'm getting into it. Right. You know, so again, that's what makes a good needle drop for me. If I'm like, I want to hear that now because, you know, and it connects it. So,
Awesome.
All right. There you are, Andrew.
All right. So now from here on out, like I said, 3-1 are songs that I knew beforehand and loved beforehand, and then saw them in the movie. They saw how they were dropped into the movies and took it to a whole nother level, another echelon of loving the movie, or sorry, loving the song. And so I will again let the clip do some of the talking before I talk.
Bricked up, thought smashing up our arcade might help me to persuade Mickey to fight.
Yes.
And if that wasn't enough, he thought it would be a good idea to burn Mickey's mum's caravan.
Absolutely.
While she was asleep in it.
That part right there. That right there, when the song kicks in. Oh my gosh. And then I'll let it run a little long because one of my favorite parts in it is that part where the song kicks in. And then after it kind of cools down, you'll see that I love that shot.
Such a powerful scene, man.
Oh man. And
I forgot about this.
It definitely hits hard at the same this. So you see the glow.
20 years.
You see the glow off his face, and you see the pulse. You feel the pulse, the beat there, and you see the fire in his eyes and fire off his face. Oh man, just shivers, pure goosebumps on that one.
A couple of Brad Pitt films. I just saw this.
And so that is, of course, Snatch from 2000, directed by Guy Ritchie, and the song is Massive Attack, Angel. And so I loved Massive Attack in college, huge band for me, and Angel was my favorite song from them. And so when that dropped in that movie, again, like I said in an earlier one, pure goosebumps, because I was like, as soon as the song started, I was like, Massive Attack, like, woo. And so then that scene happened, and it like just blew my mind. And fun fact, I thought about it earlier today. Massive Attack was one of the last concerts that I've seen before all the crap went down, and back with it would have been in 2019. And I was like, oh my gosh, but I mean if that's one of my last concerts, I'm not mad at that, but it also made me sad because I was like, oh, I saw Massive Attack and they're one of the last concerts I might go to for a long time. Anyway, but sadness aside, I love that scene, and Guy Ritchie does a great job. He has a lot of great soundtracks.
Oh, absolutely.
And he times it up perfectly.
I mean, that's the theme, eh? Like, I wasn't really thinking that way, but we've mentioned some of them without realizing it. It's these certain directors, right? They can put it together.
That have a certain style. That's part of their style, right? So yeah, that one was definitely going to make my list because of just the combo of the two.
It's funny. I think Matt will know what I'm going to say. So I forgot all about that. I saw that movie, like, I think 2002 or three, and I haven't seen it since. I own it. It's fantastic. And I feel like I need to watch it more often. But so what's funny about that song is that reminds me of a TV show, the season 4 finale of The West Wing. There's a plot of a terrorist group to like kidnap the president's daughter. And like the last 6 minutes as it's all going down, as she's in a club, is set to Massive Attack, Angel. Really? So they're like, the Secret Service is outside. They're like talking. And then you see like the guy, I remember the thing where she's like gets like date raped, like drugged. And then it picks up when they're like, when they put the bag over her head and pull her back. So like, as soon as you said, I'm like, oh my God, that's from The West Wing. What movie is this from? And he said Snatch. And I'm like, but yeah, I have always, so that would have been after this, that would have been like 2003, four, season 4. And so I've always thought of West, when I hear that song, I 100% think of the kidnapping of Zoe Bartlett.
Not only except because it's a different medium, right? It's TV versus movies. But one thing, and I'll nitpick, just to get a little mid show rant, is, and me and Matt were talking about it beforehand, is when you have an iconic song and that's used in an iconic scene that somebody uses again in a different movie, right? So you have a song that'd be like, you know that song is from that movie, right? Everyone knows that. That's a sort of thing. And then a different director will use it for a different thing. And it's like, no, you can't do that. Now is now owned by that movie, right? It was like the one I always use would be like Steeler's Wheel from Reservoir Dogs. If someone else used Stuck in the Middle of You in a different movie, be like, no, that's out of bounds. You can't that, use that.
I mean, that movie, in another that movie is that isn't directly referencing Reservoir.
Yes.
Dogs.
Yes.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
If it's
yeah,
making
yeah.
a reference to it, like then that's a different story. But yeah. if like if you're using it in your scene as a totally different scene, QT already used that one. It's done. But anyway, it's kind of rant. Mac, what's your number three?
Speaking of which,
that would be awesome.
No, but we did mention how, I mean, like Quentin Tarantino, and I mentioned them earlier just a minute ago, and we talked about it, the use of music, like especially needle drops like this, has become like a director's trademark, essentially. And the same can be said for the Coen brothers.
Oh, yeah.
A big one would be from The Big Lebowski, What Condition My Condition Is In.
Oh, my That's gosh.
An amazing so use good. Of that song. And it's essentially a music video break in the middle of the movie. But when we talked about needle drops as a topic, as after Don't Stop Me Now went through my head, I was like, oh, okay, then the next one that came up was this one from Blood Simple, the Coen Brothers' first movie.
Excellent.
Here we see Maurice the bartender just stepping over the bar. He works in a country and western bar, which...
We got both kind of music, country and western.
The house band has just stopped, so he's going to decide he's going to...
Oh, nice.
Awesome.
So the song here is the same old song by the Four Tops.
Yep.
And it's used three times in this movie. Now here he puts it in and he's gonna he's talking to this girl. It's just essentially background music for what is kind of essentially not a cheerier scene in the sense of this whole movie. It's later used when here we have Dan Haeda, who will later be killed in the movie.
Spoilers.
And yeah, spoilers. And then somebody finds another character, Ray, another bartender, finds his body and thinks it's his girlfriend who is.
This is an old friend of mine. This is Deborah.
Julie, what is his name? Marty. His name's Marty. So he Ray shows up and he thinks his wife, Marty's wife, had killed him. So he's trying to cover it up. I don't have the clips for all of that, but he essentially is hiding the body. And you can hear Maurice come to work. He pops a quarter in the jukebox and the song plays again. And then it's used again one more time when at the end of the movie where, oh my God, what is her name? Somebody. She's in all of their movies.
Frances McDormand
has killed somebody. She thinks it's Marty. She doesn't realize Marty is dead. Mrs. She shoots Cohen. Somebody else.
Yeah.
And just before the credits hit, you see this guy's dead body and then it hits again, just right from the beginning. And it's amazing use. And it's a perfect song because of kind of the lyrics that are used. It's the same old song with a different meaning since you've been gone. And each time the song is used, especially juxtaposed the scene, you can feel it has a completely different meaning. Here in the clip I just showed, it's just background music in the bar. Next, it's being used as somebody is hiding a body, which is a completely different feeling. And again, after she's just killed a man and it hits the credits, it's like another completely different feeling.
That's good.
Originally, well, that was the song they used for the theatrical version. When it came to VHS, they had to change the song.
Oh, shoot.
They changed it to I'm a Believer, the Neil Diamond version of I'm a Believer.
Hmm.
So if you find like an original VHS, that's the song they'll use. And I've seen clips for it and it's just campy. It does not work at all. And then when they got to do the director's cut, they were able to get the rights back and fit the correct song in those three spots, which fits terrifically. The song itself, they use the song as kind of an in-joke. Again, like the lyrics say, it's the same. The song itself, I'm going to go all the way back, was a hit for the Four Tops. Their hit before that was Sugar Pie, Honey Bunch. It became a huge hit. And Berry Gordy was like, okay, we need another one immediately. So the songwriters took the music, kind of reversed it, and it kept the same chord progression and changed the lyrics. But the lyrics are joke because it's the same old song.
That's right.
But with a different meaning since you've been gone.
It's funny.
And the Coen brothers wanted to use it because their inspiration for becoming filmmakers were the old noir films, which they kind of admit to be like, oh, we just stole that kind of stuff and put it in our own movie. So we wanted to use that song, the same old song, because obviously something looks familiar. And they wanted to use that as a joke to help familiar their movies are to the movies that inspired them of the 30s and 40s.
That's cool. It's like that almost the song almost becomes like a character in the movie.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Like kind of like hopefully it's not on anybody's list, but Groundhog Day. Right. It becomes a part of the movie, right? And not just a reference to the scene, but it becomes an actual thing.
Could you imagine if they had to re-release that, they cut that song and put a different song in?
In Groundhog Day?
Yeah.
Like, Forget it. Yeah, it would totally change the movie.
That's what Matt was alluding to, right? Like,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Because now that is a part of the movie. It is like not just it's referencing the actual movie.
Yeah.
As the movie progresses. That's cool. I like that.
Nice. All right, Scott, what you got for number three?
Cool. Okay, so for my number three, it's funny. Matt's like a step ahead of me, interestingly enough, because this one on my list is for very much because of the lyrics as well. So every time I hear this song, I think of the lyrics and immediately flash to the film. To set that up, Quentin Tarantino's good at needle drops. We all know that. Mm-hmm. What I have next is a Quentin Tarantino needle drop. If you Google search top 10 Quentin Tarantino needle drops, this one would not be on it. I do not know why. I love this scene of the film and no one ever really likes it. Even today, AB was messaging me because somebody on another podcast was talking about a needle drop from this film. And that one gets a lot of the attention, but that one's just fun. This one actually has context to the story and what I'm talking about.
Speaking of QT, there he is. There he is.
That's blowing up. Is John Legend's Who Did That to You? So I remember seeing this scene in theaters and losing my mind how cool this looks. Just listen to these lyrics too.
Uh-oh.
Sorry, guys. Yeah, that was me. I was flipping through.
That's okay.
Now, I'm not afraid to do the Lord's work. He says vengeance is his, but I'm going to do it first. I'm going to handle my business in the name of the law. It's perfect. This sets up the whole third act of Django going back to get his wife from Candyland. So the whole film, he's been spending with King Schultz, learning how to be almost a hitman assassin. In this, he gets captured by Quentin Tarantino and these Australian farmers. And as the scene's going, he's going back for his revenge. So it sets up a perfect death match. King Schultz is dead, and it's Calvin Candy versus Django right now. So the reason why I love it is not only for the beginning opening paragraph of John Legend's verse in this, but when you watch the movie, you're ready for the rematch, essentially. You're ready for Django to go back to get his wife. But the other thing that I love, and I'm going to fast forward a little bit, is this. When he goes to the slaves, opens up the back of the case, asks for the dynamite, which he throws, and rides off. And a very subtle, unbelievable director's choice that I'm almost surprised Quentin Tarantino made it is the shot of this man's face. Knowing that at this moment, Django has become a symbol and inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
And he's nodding and he's like, go get him. Because we at the audience at this time are like, fuck yeah, Django, go get him.
Yeah.
And then, like I said, the perfect mix of the song and the fact that it's John Legend's Who Did That to You, which, again, came out. I mean, I can never find if it was written for the song or if it came out. John Legend will never sing it again. Like, it's not a big song, but it could be. Like, that song could have received radio play, but it's kind of just forgotten in, like, the history of his lexicon because he came out with the Selma song maybe 2 years later with Common. And again, when you bring up Quentin Tarantino needle drops, this never gets discussed, but it's one of my favorite Quentin Tarantino scenes because, like I said, the weight, the magnitude, and like I said, how you feel in the theater when that hits. And yeah, QT blows up and explodes. And out of the smoke, you get the John Legend verse. It's a perfect amalgamation of everything. The lyrics, the song, and the tension of the scene. It's an unbelievable scene that I'm always all in on.
I feel like I like the idea better that it doesn't get a lot of play later because it feels more just part of this movie.
Yeah, rather of course.
Than,
yeah,
do you know what I mean? So it's more weaved, interweaved into like the
hit.
Yeah. Yeah, because then, yeah, especially because of the movie and the scene and what you're talking mm-hmm. about, the power that it has, if it became just sort of a pop hit and people were just singing it on the bus or whatever,
right?
It would like kill that scene, right? That moment. So it's kind of good in this scenario. Yeah.
Because it like savors it a little more that like no one knows about that song. Like I guarantee you, like I'm a John Legend fan, but like I guarantee you most people who are self-proclaimed John Legend fans probably don't even remember that song. So
sure. And then you get that little job. You get that little cool hipster feel of like, I know that one, you don't.
Yeah, true, right? True.
Like that little,
For sure. Yes.
All right, sure gents, we'll get talking about.
We'll be talking about Quentin again.
I was figured he would be on here, but I was like, oh man, I hope he is.
Who's if he's not? They would have picked him first. We saw that coming.
But yeah, you mentioned like picking that song, and of course, for Quentin, making the movie isn't the end of making the movie. You have to add those. You know, he picks out songs before. I mean, as he's writing scripts.
Yeah.
And I was just wanted to look it up. And he's been nominated for 5 Grammy Awards for compiling these soundtracks, including Django. He hasn't won any yet, but that's just, you know, another notch on his belt.
He's got such an ear. Obviously he's a huge cinephile, but he's also obviously a huge music lover and has an ear for the right song in the right spot. Because I mean, he's used some hits in his, obviously some hits in his movies, but the vast majority of the songs that he uses in his movies are not hits at all. Zero hits. Even like the older stuff he uses are like obscure, you know, songs from the 70s or, you know, like, and so like, that's what things I like is that he unearths these, and then that's the thing he loves doing, right? He loves unearthing obscure films, and he loves
bringing actors
and these things that this is a song you should know about. This is an actor you should know about. Like, check this out.
Well, that's that hipster vibe. I love it. Like, I'm gonna bring this and show you what you should like. Yeah.
And I'm here for it. I'm here for it. I want to know about these old films and all these old songs.
All right, gents, get out those whiteboards and markers.
Oh, here we go.
This is gonna be the hardest one of the evening. I'll throw a couple hints out there. I have seen this musical act twice in concert. That's was my there one hint.
Either time.
I'm not giving any further hints. And so this will be the most difficult one. I won't play too much of it, but I'm hoping more the movie will trigger than really the song or anything. It's all instrumental for the record. All right, I'm going to stop it there. And I knew that was going to be harder. And obviously the clip will do justice when I show it. But I just want to see what vibe you're getting from that. Because for me, the movie right away comes out when I hear this. So what do you got, gents? What do you think?
No,
I love that guess, Wizard of Oz.
Oh, is it 28?
Yeah, isn't it when you sync up Pink Floyd to Wizard of Oz?
That's not Pink Floyd.
Yes, I had nothing. What is it?
Andrew has it. It is Godspeed You Black Emperor, who is from Montreal. And let me just share my screen here. They're from Montreal, and they were surprisingly, like, blew my mind when I heard them show up, and I'll talk about why in a sec, on the soundtrack, or at least in the film, to 28 days later. Now, I'm not going to play this whole thing. I'm just going to skip a little bit. But basically, just make sure my sound. Oh, there we go. Hold on. There we go. So this is obviously when he first gets up, wakes up, comes out of the hospital, and realizes, well, there's something that's gone wrong. Something is up, right? And you pick a band like this that is basically just plays like experimental sound noise. There's about 9 members, and they just play 20-minute long songs that build to these big crescendos. As soon as this played and I saw it in the theater, I went, oh, that's Godspeed. Because all they do is build up to these, like, these just destroying, like, they destroy you, these crescendos. I'm just going to jump ahead a little here. And, you know, just a little bit more here. And it builds, and it builds to, and it kind of pulls you in, right? And I thought it was perfect because it just gives you this vibe of, like, no hope.
Yeah. Like, honestly, like, I love the whole movie, but this is my favorite scene, bar none. Like,
absolutely.
Like, the most this scene is unreal. Yeah.
The most terrifying. I love this moment, though, here where he gets to the car. Little jump scare for you here. But the whole point here, and I'll just jump to it here, is they just build faster, faster. And it's like crashing in on you, right?
Yeah.
And he gets to that board and he sees all the faces of all the missing people and he realizes, like, something has gone on while I've been unconscious in this hospital, right? To the point where eventually just, you know, crashes down. But that one for me has a few reasons I chose it. One of which, I mean, to hear a band like that you would never hear in a movie ever, in a movie, in a scene like that, blew me away. But then I did a little research on it because you can't, and we were talking before this, we were talking about soundtracks and you know, what you can and can't find on a soundtrack. Well, this song is nowhere on the 28 Days Later soundtrack. Yeah. And for the main reason that, so when Danny Boyle came up with this idea, because this is Danny Boyle, obviously, and when he came up with this idea, he actually, in his head, scored the whole thing to Godspeed You Black Emperor. He wanted, I was amazing to me that he knew who they were, because they're just a collective in from Montreal who just doesn't do any really big shows. They stay away from Ticketmaster. They're really low key. They hate corporate anything. If you ask them to do something, they'll tell you to, you know, screw off. And he basically approached them and said, like, I want you for this film. He like wined and dined him. He brought him to like a vegan cafe. They sat down. He said, here's the idea. Here's the movie. It's this little indie project. It's this and that. And they agreed. And this is the song East Hastings, which again is it's like an 18-minute song. Yeah. And this is obviously one snippet of it. And they finally agreed because they, under the idea of, okay, this is a small little film, here's what the scene is gonna be, I can appreciate that. And then what happened was the Fox Searchlight purchased the film, and then it became a much bigger film than it was supposed to be. And Godspeed You Black Emperor was pissed. And it was just like, you know, back and forth. And eventually they agreed to allow this little bit in the scene, but it couldn't be on any merchandising for any money to be made off of it or anything else. And I just thought that was like, so like the story of that to me blew me away. The scene is really powerful. And it's funny because I was even looking further, and I guess Oliver Stone really wanted Godspeed as well. And get this, they wanted from the same album, different song, same album, Any Given Sunday. He wanted to use Godspeed You Black Emperor. And this killed me because they right off the bat said, screw you. You know when the quarterback, whatever, he's throwing the football, it's the big epic moment, and he throws the foot. That's what he wanted, Godspeed song. And they're like, we're not gonna give you a song to show this guy throwing a great touchdown pass or something. And, like, but Oliver Stone apparently cut the whole scene, used the song, like did it all, and they said no, and then he had to recut the whole thing.
That's wild. I didn't even know that.
I love that. That's cool. Great.
Yeah. So I mean, just really powerful to me. And I really, that was a time in my life too, when I really listened to a lot of Godspeed and a lot of just that like experimental sort of just like doom kind of music. And went to see it in a film, a zombie, if you will, film, blew my mind. So for no one else, this won't click like a regular needle drop, but for me, it's just like, oh, I know who that is, you know? You know, so.
Yeah. That's great.
So that's my number three.
All right, so we are up to number two. So you went from, you said East Hastings is an 18-minute song. Yeah. I will not up you on that, but I'll almost meet you with a 17-minute song.
Hey!
This is a song that I used to listen to when I was a kid. And so when it showed up in this movie, it took this movie to another level. And I love this movie, and Scott will know how much I love this movie.
Yes! Oh,
yeah, cool.
And so this is movie. This is a song that's in the movie. He's playing it on his radio, and so the main character is walking up to the house, and he can hear the music in the distance coming from the house. Can you hear it?
Yeah.
There you go.
It's just the hard part hasn't
been. Yeah, I hear it.
Yeah, it's coming.
Oh. Oh man! Again, just that way it's timed up with that. And like I would do, obviously I'm not going to show you the whole scene, but you can hear as he's walking up, you can hear the whole intro for the, or like a big part of the song. And so this is where it gets to the crazy part of the song, and get obviously the crazy part of the scene. And so, yeah, it was a perfect choice. And so this is again when I saw this movie, this popped for me huge because I love this song. And I was already loving this movie, and that took it to that next level because I was like, holy crap, you're using this song for this? Anyway, but I do. You get the gist.
The song being, you haven't said it yet.
Okay, I will get to that. The movie is Manhunter from 1986, directed by Michael Mann, and the song is Iron Butterfly, Inagata Davida.
I love that movie, and yes. I saw it not long after, but William Peterson, who plays
Will Graham
role in that,
yep,
was a star for CSI. I had watched, maybe three seasons of CSI before I saw that movie, and I just happened to like flip upon it, and I was like, that's young William Peterson. This is great. And then going through the movie, he's essentially the same CSI
character. Yeah, he's a lot of very similar character.
This is amazing. And then it clicked. Oh, this is the first Hannibal Lecter movie.
Yeah,
this is right up my wheelhouse.
Yeah, it was a similar for me. I saw, I was not a CSI guy, but I obviously ate up Silence of the Lambs. So when I saw Silence of the Lambs, I started getting into it, I found out it was a book, right? And be like, oh, what is this book? Oh, Thomas Harris. And so then I found out about Manhunter because of that, and watched Manhunter, and obviously I won't say it's Silence of the Lambs level, but for me, it's near that for me, as I love it. And so when Red Dragon came out, I was like, no, I don't need Red Dragon. I have Manhunter already. Mm. And so, it's funny. I used to listen to that song, with my headphones on because, there's a parts in it, especially there's a big drum solo in it, and the drum solo is in stereo. So it'll go back and forth and around and stuff. So I ate that up when I was a little kid, that kind of stuff. Another one was Led Zeppelin, Whole Lot of Love, and it would swirl around. So I love that. So, again, like I said, when he fired it up in the movie, I was like, I was all in. I was all in on that scene. I was all in on that thing. And then when he crashed through the window as the song hit, I was like, ooh, I'm like, oh, that's it. That's it. I'm a Manhunter fan forever. So that's my number two.
Awesome.
All right. He doesn't need that much of a lead in. We've talked about him before.
There you go.
It's really good. I mean, I know
it's the epitome of the category.
It's the best. Okay? It's the best possible outcome when you do it. I agree.
Again, all of the songs on my list come from stereo or radio.
Joey and Jerry Rafferty.
Oh
man,
K. Billy, Stephen Wright.
Yeah, his voice, man.
That reached up to number five. Oh. K. Billy sounds of the 70s.
This movie is so good.
Yeah, this is obviously Reservoir Dogs from our boy QT. The song is Stuck in the Middle with You by Steelers
Wheel.
Great
shot, too. That's like, there's a few things. Like, that shot on, is it Eddie? Is his security guard's name?
No.
What is it?
His name is...
It, just the shot of him.
Oh, Marvin Nash. Marvin Nash.
Marvin Nash,
yeah.
Okay.
Nice guy Eddie is Sean Petty.
Yeah.
Sean Penn.
Yeah.
Chris Penn. Yeah.
Sean Penn.
So Whitten said in an interview that the entire soundtrack budget was spent securing this song.
Really?
He was content with having no other music in the film, as long as he could use the song.
Wow.
The other songs were secured thanks to the producers managing to land a soundtrack record deal. So that's how they got all the other music for the movie. Now he did have another choice. If he did have another choice, if he couldn't get it, do anybody know what it is?
I think
What would go there? I mean, I can't hear anything other than that.
I've heard it, but especially I don't remember.
Since Michael Madsen is singing along. So if they couldn't get that song, they'd kind of be screwed. He'd have to re-edit the movie.
Oh, what was it going to be?
Ballroom Blitz was his second choice.
Yeah. Well, and it's a much faster song too, and it wouldn't go with his dancing.
No.
So this is much better. It's more
so. We've talked about this scene before off here, and one of the things I love about this scene and this song is that he goes to his car to get the gasoline.
That was what I was going
to
say.
Yeah. And you hear it. The music stops as he exits, and then he comes back in, and you hear the song again. And I love that.
Which is what makes you know it's on there.
Yeah.
Love that. So yeah, it's iconic for a reason. And again, that song was basically nothing. It was a minor hit for Steelers Wheel. It was nothing big, and then that movie drops, and now everybody knows that song, and everyone knows where it came from.
I have the funniest story too. This just totally popped. This is a story from like 20 years ago. So after I'd seen that movie, I think I was on like Kazam, like remember like post Napster, there's Kazam, and I'm pretty sure I downloaded this song, but it said it was Steve Miller Band.
Oh my god!
So I was like, for probably a decade, I was like, Stuck in the Middle with You by Steve Miller Band, and then I'm like, once I got like my iTunes and everything's organized, I was like, is this a cover? Well, this is the one. Oh, that's weird. It was just like labeled wrong. Like I just downloaded. So I've always like for some reason been like, to associate that song with like Steve Miller Band because I spent a decade thinking it was them.
I feel like that needs to be a question in the quickie. Like, what band did Scott?
Yeah, I mean, that would have been like easy. I listen to this song all the time. Yeah, man. Steve Miller Band. Like, why? I'm like, that's what Napster
does. Yeah.
There is a lot of, I've had that experience as well. There's a lot of parody songs that are credited to Weird Al, but are not him.
Yeah.
Especially in the days of Napster when stuff was mislabeled.
Yeah, that stuff used to boil my blood.
Yeah.
Oh, it still happens. It happens on YouTube, right? Because anybody can upload songs and upload videos and mislabel them. And the one I got in a huge argument with our boy Fontaine was I swear. And Skane both said it was Boys to Men. And they showed me this YouTube video, Boys to Men. I was like, no chance that was Boys to Men. Boys to Men is never, ever saying, I swear. But anyway, I digress.
But that's because they labeled it wrong. That's what you were getting
at. That's right. Like, yeah.
All right. I like it. I like mine. These tangents. Scott.
Wait, did you just, what's that? I thought, he did Man. Oh, you did. Okay, of course. I, for some reason, thought, Matt was up next. Okay, so my number two would have showed up on a future list. Now we have a future list coming up, and this scene would have been on that list. Now I tell myself, use it on the higher list. This would have probably been 5 or 4 on the upcoming Marvel episode that we're going to do. I knew I would slot it in at about a 1 or a 2. And I chose... from Guardians of the Galaxy, So Quill had already opened up the letter from his mother, which is in itself an incredible scene. And she leaves him the volume 2. So in it, he puts it on, and it's Ain't No Mountain High Enough by Tammy Terrell. And so in that, she talks about Gamora dancing earlier in the movie. So now she's getting a little bit of dancing, comfortable upon it. What I love about the scene, more than anything, is this shot of Michael Rooker. So when you've seen the movie, this Quill gives him the orb, but Rooker expects something's not right. So he knows, while everyone's partying, he opens it up and sees that it was a troll all along. And because he trained Quill properly, issues that really sly, coy smile. Like he's proud he got one over on him, which I think is awesome. Of this, you get Glenn Close, you get John C. Reilly's character being reunited with his family. But again, it's a perfect needle drop in the fact the movie's loaded with him. Opposite Suicide Squad, these are done properly and well with some mainstream and James Gunn, some lesser than. And it's leading to my all-time favorite movie line of all time. We'll save that for another time. But what's perfect?
We'll do it now. We'll edit it into the next video.
So like I said, that would have been about 5 or 4 on that list. I had some Marvel scenes above. So I knew, I'm like, I'll use it on the higher one. Like I said, what I love about this, it ties the whole film together perfectly. You get Gamora starting to experience some comfort with her new family, obviously her character arc. You get Quill's character arc is not opening the gift, and then he finally does as well too. And then, like I said, now everyone has come together, and it's setting up for their next adventure. And what I say, the last thing I'll say about this too, is what Guardians of the Galaxy does well, that Suicide Squad tries to replicate, is the needle drops in it. And that's an interesting subject into itself, like the overuse of needle drops in Suicide Squad was ultimately to its detriment. But I know I was listening to an interview or a director's commentary with James Gunn, who's like, he fought the studio countless times because he wanted to use a lot of music. He like they wanted to use, it's what we talked about earlier, a lot of pop 70s stuff that was super popular. And James Gunn's like, well, I'll use some pop and I'll use a lot of the stuff that I liked. Cherry Bomb and stuff like that.
Redbone, Come and Get Your Love.
Yeah, that like was not very big, but he's like, that's what I listen to and it's my movie and tough. But I listened to an interview with him once where he's like, over my dead body, 100%, I knew that I was not going to use in that scene. I was never going to use Ain't No Mountain High Enough. He did not want to use Ain't No Mountain High Enough. And he's like, I wanted to fly because everyone expected it. And he's like, he tried so hard to find a song. And he's like, I could not find another song that conveyed like the love between a man and a woman that's like not sexual because it was a mother and a son.
Right.
And he's like, we tried so hard day and night to find other songs to not have to use Ain't No Mountain High Enough. And then he's like, it's the best call. It was in front of us all along. Like just use Ain't No Mountain High Enough. And it ended up being, like I said, one of the best Marvel moments. And it ends directly, goes into Jackson 5 for the end. And you leave the theater on a hot, super high note and a happy note. But like I said, for letter into that, into the exclamation marks on all the character arcs, I go with Ain't No Mountain High Enough from 2014's Guardians of the Galaxy.
I have one for him, but it was already used in Ghostbusters 2. Jackie Wilson,
Love Lifting You Higher.
Made my shortlist originally. It's already taken.
Yeah.
You know what I was thinking, Scott? I appreciate this song about to mother and son. Or it's Always Sunny. When they do the play, baby boy, my baby boy. That one.
Sure, that's funny.
My little baby boy.
The thing with Guardians, both of the Guardians movies, is, and especially the first one, mostly the first one, is what we were talking about earlier, where the music is a big part of the actual movie because of the tape, right, and the significance of the tape.
Yeah.
And it is a it's almost like a character in the movie because we know the significance of each song, right? We know the significance of each song and like him listening to him on the Walkman, right? We know that all these songs mean so much to him because of the significance of his mom. So I love that James Gunn did that because the music is important. Music is huge in that movie, especially that first one.
Yeah. Usue 1973, that song belongs to me.
Well, yeah. See, okay, now that's another example of what I'm about to say, because Blue Suede was used in Reservoir Dogs.
That's right.
So when it was used for Guardians of the Galaxy, I was like, no, that's from Reservoir.
Yeah, Dogs. I was thinking that too. I'm like,
and you know, Ain't No Mountain Blue High Suede. Enough for
Stepmom
for everybody. Yeah, for a lot of people, yes. It's going to be Guardians, but for me, when it hit, I was like, oh, that's the song from Stepmom. Yeah. And that's where it sticks for me forever.
Yeah. Mm.
But I like cool. that. I mean, in some ways, you can have it both ways, where it's just
you can.
This is
yeah.
a special thing for
if
me.
If it's a big enough song, especially if it's a big enough yeah. song, like Hooked on a Feeling is not a big enough song where you hear it a lot, right? So you get that. You're like, that is definitely from Reservoir Dogs. Ain't No Mountain High Enough is one of the biggest songs in Motown. So like, of course, it's going to be heard all over the place,
and it's going to be a generational thing because yeah. kids will mm-hmm. see Guardians of the Galaxy before mm-hmm. they see Reservoir Dogs or even Stepmom.
Yeah.
So they'll know the songs from that before they see.
We get to super generational with my number one.
I like the idea that the kids are
my number one.
I like the idea.
Very generational.
Can I say? I like the idea that kids are sitting down and they're like, "Okay, what are we going to watch this weekend? Okay, well, first Guardians, then Reservoir Dogs, and then we got to finish it up with Stepmom."
We should come up with off camera. We should do tribons of like three songs that were used in three movies and see what Ooh. Wild oh my connections God. We get.
Okay, okay.
We're rambling. We got to get out okay. of here under 2 hours.
Yeah,
here we go.
What am I on?
Number two.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So get my there. Next, my oh, my yeah. two and one. My two and one are, yeah, get your boards ready. My two and one are very much, for me anyways, like, this song is this movie. So, like, yeah. I hear it, it's that movie. Like, more than anything else. So, let's play a little bit of this one for you here, guys.
I know.
And I love this song. All right, that's good for that. We'll stop
yeah,
that there.
Yeah.
I absolutely love that song. Flip them around if you know them.
It's not, yeah, it's not called.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And oh, I and Andrew's even got, yep, Gary Jules. I guess it says featuring Gary Jules. I don't know if it's because it's like,
it's the so the guy who composed the guy who composed this the soundtrack, like the,
and then
the score,
he sang on
the song, and he right? sang over top of it.
Yeah.
So
then it kind of became sort of like his song. Like I think there's even a music video for it that I remember yeah. seeing. This is not that I'm going to share. This is going to be from the film. But obviously, for those who didn't notice or whatever, it's Donnie Darko, 2001. This was, of course, on another list of mine. I know this just happens a lot with me, but for me, this is so powerful because mm-hmm. of where it happens in the film and what is occurring while it's playing. So I'm just going to play a little bit here. I just got to get my sound changed. Familiar faces, worn out places, worn out I'll explain places, a little after. Dark scene there visually.
My cousin.
Yeah.
That's my cousin right there.
Obviously, all the characters going through some sort of turmoil, which I seem to like in movies.
She's in turmoil because Sparkle Motion. She's doubting her, doubting her belief in Sparkle Motion.
Now, I want to get to what you'll notice is, if you've seen the film, this is the part where alternate things are occurring because of what Jake Gyllenhaal has decided to allow to happen to him. And so I just want to get to this last one here, which is more the iconic.
Oh yeah. That's the big reveal, right?
Yeah. And then you see him, who's Frank, if you will, the bunny, who doesn't get shot in the face here. And there's a lot more to this, and it sort of goes to all the different characters, and you see him feeling his face. And so, I mean, if you don't know much, I mean, that film deals with, you know, time travel and alternate dimensions and things. And that scene, that moment, is immediately sort of after. It's the day after when this plane engine falls from the sky and lands on the house where Donnie lives. And instead of, like, not being in his bed, he he knowing what's going to happen, he's in his bed and it lands on him and it changes everyone else's life and allows them to have either a good life or live. And it just, and he does it knowingly. And it's like this really powerful moment where you watch all of these different things happen because this one, you know, character decided that's okay, I'm going to sacrifice myself for that. And so that song for me is so perfect because of that. And that's what, that's why that gets my number two.
Not one of the
directors that we've been listing, right? But still, nonetheless, I quite enjoy it.
I'm a huge Tears for Fears guy, and so I'm not a big covers fan. I don't love a lot of cover versions of songs. So when I heard that song, I loved it immediately. It's one of my favorite cover songs of any song, and it's, you're right, and the regular version's a lot more, you know, upbeat and it's still sad, but it's like more, it's got a beat to it and all that stuff. So this stripped down, like, naked version of it is so powerful, and you're right, it's like that scene, it just makes that scene,
yeah,
and I mean, like, I get goosebumps. I actually listened to that song today because it was on somebody on a podcast list. And I got goosebumps listening to it, because it's just a great version of that song, and even like the lyrics go so well with this.
And it's again kind of thinking of how, you know, the Pixies one was at the end. This is towards the end of the film. It's about a 3-minute scene, and you're basically wrapping up all the story arcs of every character during that song, right? So in a montage, not the usual kind of montage.
Now, I can't remember if I put it on my list for a previous episode of movies I've never seen, but if I did, it's still on there.
Yeah.
So I've yet to have seen Donnie Darko.
I feel like I've seen it once, but I always want to go back to it.
Yeah,
but I know
I'm going to like it way more.
But I do know this song because it was used in an episode of CSI.
Okay.
And a commercial for Gears of War.
Yeah, the video game. I wouldn't have been able to tell you the game, but I knew it was a game.
Gears of War commercial. When I first came on, I was like, "What is this?"
I didn't know that was in a
commercial. And then I watched I saw the whole thing. I'm like, man, that's really cool. It actually works really well. It actually works really well. But there was that 2 or 3 second where I was infuriated because I was like, how dare you steal Donnie Darko and use it for this filth, whatever this is.
Yeah. That's funny. All right. Number one.
Okay, here we go. Number one. Do you guys have any guesses?
Quentin Tarantino.
No, zero. Zav, zero
QT. I had one. I'm wondering where... where Tiny Dancer or Hurdy-Gurdy Man are.
Oh, here we go. The Tiny, we talked about this before off air. Tiny Dancer should have made my list. And it is definitely a great one. I just got sick of it because it's talking about so much.
Go ahead.
I don't need to do things. No, I've already talked about this movie. I've already talked about the scene. And I didn't talk about the song though on it. This is one of my favorite movies. This is my favorite 5 minute, but this is another super long song. I forget how long this one is. It might even be longer than that other one. This is
of course. I should have guessed.
Yeah,
so I guess I can talk over it. Is Apocalypse Now from 1979, directed by Francis Ford Coppola, and you can start to hear in the background The Doors, The End. Yeah, this right here is my favorite thing in any movie, right there. That's it. And it's got the Doors building on the background over it, the lightning flashes. This part's kind of brutal with the beast actually getting sacrificed. But
your audio's muted.
Yeah, I don't hear your Doors playing at all. I thought it was just slowly.
Oh, it's my volume's up.
Yeah, but you gotta click your button here.
Oh shoot, okay.
Yeah, because I was like, maybe it's just coming in.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Yeah, no worries. Hold on. And if you need to go back.
I will go back.
Because I want to hear the build-up. Yeah, now I'm in suspense.
Yeah. Okay, here we go.
Worst case, I'm in.
Technical difficulties.
That's all right.
Come on, baby, take a chance.
Oh, there we go. Okay.
Jungle wanted him dead. And that's who he really took his orders from, anyway.
There we go. This works a lot better now that I'm hearing that.
Yeah, and this right here, and you can hear the thunder hit, lightning.
It's really good. It's really good, man.
And like this again, like we've talked, like Mike talked about in his song, and then and also in the God of Davida, it's this long instrumental part of the song that builds and builds and builds to a crescendo where he ends up murdering Kurtz. In as the real like crazy part of the song hits, and then it calms back down again, comes back down to the end and hits the end of the song. And I won't go into the thing because it's a super long scene. You get the gist of it. But I just love this. I love that the lightning flashes with, you know, the light and dark, and the whole movie he's struggling with his own darkness, and he has the light and the dark, the two shadows. Like, the lighting in this whole scene is unbelievable.
Yeah.
Yeah. I won't get into this part because that part's pretty gruesome. So I'll stop it before it gets to the real.
Yeah. If you're a fan of cows, turn away.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, kid. Yeah.
It's turning away.
Yeah. Okay. And so, basically that scene and that song. And as it comes down, as the song winds down after he's already, you know, hit him a bunch of times with the machete, it gets to the iconic line, the horror, the horror, the horror. And that as the song, you know, finishes its cycle. And like, to me, the Doors were, we talked about Queen earlier, and Queen was one of my dad's bands. And my dad liked a lot of the classic rock bands. He did not like the Doors at all, and so the Doors were one of the bands that I got to discover on my own, and that I like came to on my own. And so I definitely was a Doors fan. I'm a big Doors fan. I have that album that's on, and so I already love that song, and I love these big epic long songs, especially with big instrumentals in the middle and that build to a big crashing end. And again, when I saw this, it all came together, and you hear the Doors at the beginning of the movie too. And there was already this, I think I talked about it in our previous episode, there was always this, like, even before I saw it, there was this taboo of seeing this movie because my mom had this whole thing where she thought it was a different movie, so she wouldn't let me see it. But it had already reached legendary status because of that, and then because of the opening with the Doors start playing, and I'm like, oh my gosh, like I'm already in love. And like he gets to that final scene, and it's just perfect. It's a perfect blending of the two, of the song and the visuals to go with it. So yeah, Apocalypse Now, my number one.
Nice. Kidding. That's good.
All right, Matthew, what do you got?
Well, my number one is another Queen hit.
Here we go.
Again, I don't think it needs Andrew writing on the board.
No, yeah.
Gentlemen, a little Bohemian Rhapsody.
This is
a fun fact.
Absolutely.
No, it's funny. Dana Carvey didn't bother to learn the lyrics, so he's always off just a little bit.
It works, though.
Yeah. Again, and like for so many people, this song was introduced to me through this movie.
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure I've heard it. I had heard it once before because my mom, both my parents were huge fans of Queen. So it probably played in the house, but this definitely changes, not the meaning, but certainly the emotion between it, of the song. Because any group of people who are in a car and the song comes on are going to sing along.
Yeah.
And just headbang to it.
I love Phil getting his second wind here. That's my favorite part of the scene. Phil getting his second wind and getting it. Because
this song will do that for you.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
It gets into this whole thing. He's just completely partied out, man. Phil's partied out.
Now the director, Penelope, how do you pronounce Spheeris. Your last name?
Spheeris.
Spheeris?
Yep.
She had them do take after take after take of the headbanging. That really? It pretty much damaged their necks for like the rest of the movie. You can see in other scenes that they're having trouble moving their necks because it kept
should have shot that scene
all
last.
Of the headbanging takes damaged their necks, and her and Mike Myers did not get along during the production of the movie.
So her that director Penelope Spheeris, when we did our music or our documentary, she directed one of my music documentaries, and she did The Decline of Western Civilization, which is a punk rock documentary, and she did the second one, Metal Years. I just found out that like recently, I didn't put the two and two together. So when we did that music documentary. Or the documentary episode, I was like, Penelope Spheeris, so what else has she done? And I'm like, Wayne's World? What? Like,
yeah, come on. This was her first feature film.
She only did those documentaries. So, like, it's funny because she brought that, like, punk aesthetic to it, right? The med banging and all that. But it's funny. Again, like I said, my dad is a big Queen guy. And so I'd heard the song before. And so I grew up listening to Queen records. I have that, my dad's vinyl of Night of the Opera sitting over here. And
does he know you have it?
Yeah. Oh yeah. I've got all his records. Yeah. It's I got all his records. I got all his good records, I should say. But like you said, that song became mine, right? That was his music. Right. Mm-hmm. And that was like something I'm like, oh, I like Queen, but that's my dad's music. When Wayne's World happened, now that's my music.
Yeah, because exactly.
So I took that over, you know, and it's crazy because that came out. That's like, I think a song came out in 1972 or 75 or 72. And anyway, it's 75 because then 1992 is when that movie came out.
Yeah.
That song went back onto the Billboard charts and it went to number 2 in America. And it only gone to number 9.
Right.
On the US charts when that song came out. Yeah. It went to number 2, like what, 20 or 17 years later?
That movie is the reason that my brother and I performed concerts for my mom. We'd get our wooden spoons and we'd get up on the bed and we'd sing that entire song and have her come in and be like, sit down, you're watching this. We've been practicing. And we would sit through the parts. We'd do the parts because of that. Yeah.
Oh man. Now,
the use of Bohemian Rhapsody was Michael Myers' decision. Like, he wanted that song. The studio wanted Guns N' Roses. Oh. He's like, no. Oh. And they fought for it and he got the I think they wanted Paradise. I think they wanted Paradise City.
Oh no.
So he fought and he got this song on there. He must have wrote to Freddie Mercury to get permission, which he granted. And then Freddie was on death's door as this movie was being produced. And there was words that maybe he wouldn't get to see the finished film and the use of the song in it. So Mike Myers quickly, after they finished it, edited it together, got a tape, mailed it to Freddie. I mean, I don't want to say moments before he died, but he did get to see that scene before he died. But he didn't get to revel in the, you know, the song becoming another chart topper again.
Yeah, that's crazy. And like, you think about, like, I mean, obviously the Bohemian Rhapsody, the movie came out and that kind of had a resurgence too. Yeah. But like, Queen became a big name again because of that movie, and like, it carried it on. You know, there's a lot of classic rock bands that have gone by the wayside that, you know, didn't get that resurgence, and it's because of this, right? It's because of the movie.
But they're like one movie away from it. Like, that's what I love about this. If somebody, you know, if a Queen or somebody comes along.
Oh, man. The case in point, Guardians of the Galaxy, Redbone, right? I just saw a whole documentary about Native Americans music, and it's from last year. And Redbone's on there, and they credit Guardians of the Galaxy with, like, bringing them into the limelight. Because even back then, when that song came out, nobody really, you know, it was a minor hit again. But Guardians of the Galaxy blew those up, and they these guys were like, what? Like, what's going on? Like, they got all this attention again. I love that. I love that. And, you know, you got these musicians that, you know, didn't go anywhere or, you know, got minor success. And now they're, you know, reveling in it because of, you know, movies.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right, Scott, number one.
I'll take us out on here. It is funny. So with this one, I don't know. It's like an encapsulation of like importance. I've had fun scenes and cool. I did the Beastie Boys to Kanye and something, but I knew like I wanted one to be something that was like important with like an important song, an important movie. And when we originally did this list, I had 30. This wasn't on it. It wasn't until recently AB and I had like this conversation in a music chat about like the most beautiful pieces of music, of art. And I had let this one slip, which is ironic because it is by far one of my all-time favorites. So I'm going to go with a song that's played towards the very end of a movie summarizing. So this movie's 3.5 hours long, and this song summarizes the entire film that came before it. So what I'm selecting is...
Yes.
And I wanted to get specifically to this part.
This fits your Tribon game.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. So this is at the 2.5 minute mark of the scene. But Spike Lee's greatest achievement will forever be this shot. This shot. Now I think I may grow to carry on. It's been a long. So I'll put these on for inspiration because I also have black frame glasses that I bought to look like Malcolm X, but clearly they don't work well enough. But with that being said,
so close.
Yeah. So what I'll say is, so that's Sam Cooke's 1963 classic, A Change Is Gonna Come, and it's played in the 1992 film Malcolm X, directed by Spike Lee, which Spike Lee has said multiple times, the best scene, best shot, best thing he's ever directed or will direct is that whole montage, specifically with that shot of him coming forward to the line. There'll be times I thought I won't last for long, but now I think I'm able to carry on. And in this, there's a lot of debate on if Spike wanted Denzel to act as if he knew Malcolm was going to die in this exact scene or how it was. But the main gist of it is that Malcolm X knew that his time was coming to an end, that he had waged a war with the Nation of Islam and that they were sending hired guns and that there was multiple close calls. Case in point, which you see in One Night in Miami as well, too. They use the same. It's almost funny because that's about the writing of this song and Malcolm X pressuring Sam Cooke to write a song that encapsulates the Black movement. And it's funny because you said earlier about like you can't use it in two. And like that's a Malcolm X song.
Yeah, it's different, but,
like,
though.
It's such a plot point that it like Regina King is like, we have to use it to end.
Like, I mean, when the movie is literally about Sam Cooke, like yes, Sam Cooke is a character in the film, that doesn't count. That doesn't count.
So like I said, so this main thing, he's recognized, he's going to his speech in New York, and this is the day, ironically enough, February 21st is the day he was assassinated, which is around this time. This is the set, today's the 17th. So it's coming right up on the, like the, gosh, what is it? Like the 1964. So coming up close to.
In the chat, guys, you can write that math out.
So, no, essentially, like I said, though, it's Denzel, crime that he didn't win the best actor. They gave it to Pacino for Son of a Woman for this year, and that's insane.
Yeah, so, no, absolutely, yeah. I agree.
And then you get Denzel playing, and like I said, he does about 25 years aged up in this, and he's playing Malcolm X at the end of his life right here, knowing with the weight of the guilt and everything that he has to do for the movement. And like I said, just with the fact, the scene, how iconic it is, and the reason why I picked it as well is what a generational song it became. You know, it's big in the 60s. You want to talk about a guy who never got to see the fruits of it? It's Sam Cooke, who was again murdered, killed right before it hit its mainstream. It was released posthumously. Comes back in 1992 with this. 2008, it's Barack Obama's election campaign song.
Yeah,
that's what he runs on with this song. So that's his. Now with this, that's pretty much 3 decades. I believe that's where I first heard it, was like the 2008 campaign tour. So you have 3 generations of this song that will stand the test of time now. So like I said, number one needle drop was Spike Lee's 1992 classic, epic, dense biopic of Malcolm X.
You know, we had hinted at mentioning what movies we want to see from each other's lists and said this wouldn't work. But guess what? I know I've seen Malcolm X.
Yeah.
But you made me want to now go. And that's a long film to go. I want to go back and watch it. But I want to go back and watch it.
I watched it today. Funny enough.
I haven't seen it in 20 years. And I definitely
a long time.
I felt the itch after I watched One Night in Miami.
And he did.
I got the itch. I got the itch to watch it. And I'm like, oh, it's 3 hours, but now I'm like, oh, I want to watch it.
You showed that
clip. Showed that clip, and I'm like, oh.
The first
we were talking today. We were talking today in the thread too about Fight the Power, and
that's good too.
Why am I blanking?
Do the Right Thing.
Do the Right Thing. Yeah, they were talking about that in one of the podcasts as a needle drop, and I was like, oh, I need some Spike. So no.
Yeah, the first 45 minutes of that movie when it's like the zoot suits and Delroy Lindo's great. I don't care. Like, I don't like about that. It's when he goes to prison. I'm like, oh, sure. This movie is fire. He's firing 120 miles an hour on this.
Yeah.
And like,
but you need that first half, of course, that first third to show his change.
And his change. And I mean, you even see it and you're like, what a wild development, because like he's so different at the beginning. But yeah, for sure. So cool. What do we got?
So yeah, after I got the itch as well after I saw One Night in Miami. I watched Malcolm X, and then I watched Ali, and the song appears in that.
Yeah,
right after Malcolm is assassinated, and Muhammad Ali hears the news. That's when they play that song.
Okay, so that's what you're saying to me is that needs to be my trifecta on this weekend. I need to do those three.
Oh my god,
Malcolm X and Ali.
Ironically enough, I.
Well, you could probably do those other two. You could probably go.
Probably release.
I'd say, do Malcolm X.
Yeah.
Ali. And then.
And then One Night in Miami. Because
it has them both. But okay. you got to do more than a trifecta. You got to get Jim Brown in there. So you got to pick a Jim Brown film.
They need to release a Jim Brown biopic.
True.
Okay, so I'll wait. All right. Get those boards ready. Let's finish this up.
Oh yeah, here we go. Ready.
All right. Now, again, like I said before, to me, this is this film. So we shall see if you agree or not.
Yeah, it's cool. The Donnie Darko one's a lot like it.
Yeah.
I actually knew this was gonna be your number one.
This is awesome.
Oh, right.
All right, I'll stop it there.
I think we all are supposed to sing it, right?
Yeah, eventually.
that's how this works.
Yeah. Well, that's what you will see shortly. Now, this is another case of I didn't see this singer in concert, but I have owned all her albums. So for me, it was like, wow, this is fantastic. So what you got here? Oh, we even got visuals of the frog falling from the sky. Yes.
Oh, we're gonna that's give, right.
Yes. Scott Andrew. Yes. Wise Up by Amy Mann from.
Very good, Scott. I like that.
Epic. Nice. The epic.
Yeah, talk about
three hour film. Now, even this scene with this song, because the song itself is almost a 4 minute song, even this scene is quite long, so I just cut it down, took it in, I went into it about a couple minutes. And as you alluded to, Andrew, this is such a needle drop for me, because the characters themselves, which within the film, each as they're going through their biggest innermost turmoil, start singing the song, which is like so intense. Shrink you to your underground and living down, but it's not going to stop. There's my boy. And even the man on his deathbed singing. That's amazing. It's not
going to stop. You was
and I think we can get to our boy too in the car here. I'm hoping there. Oh, yeah. This isn't him.
Yeah,
it's Juliana Moore, right?
Yeah.
And I mean, she's overdosing. The one guy's dying in the bed. They're all going through these. It's not Is this him here, maybe?
I think so. Yeah, you can hear him.
Our man Tom.
There's an unbelievable Paul Thomas Anderson Tom Cruise story about, have you ever heard it? Tom Cruise's father has severe father issues, and Paul Thomas Anderson cast him and pushed him to confront these.
Yeah.
And they had like a huge blow. He had like a huge breakdown on set. Like, I think his father, who was like a hardcore military guy, because he was a military brat, I think his father died like a year before this. And they talk about it on The Big Picture. Go do the homework. But they're like, there's like a course where Tom Cruise is doing like Eyes Wide Shut and Magnolia, and then is broken, and then is like, get me Mission Impossible 2. I only want to jump out of planes. I'm never challenging myself like that again. And that's literally the dividing point where he becomes Tom Cruise today. And it's because PTA and him
snapped him, broke him.
I like it. I like that.
Man. And like, honestly, he freaking owns that movie. He kills that movie.
He did not win the Oscar that year. I think Michael Caine won for Stardust Rules. And that drives me nuts that he didn't win that Oscar.
Yeah, because like that was his shot. Like, he's not gonna get another shot.
He's not gonna. He avoids that.
Yeah,
yeah. I mean, but I
that is his shot.
Oh, he's great in it. I mean, I love my movies where, you know, you get the story, one character story, the other, and then they all piece together, right? Obviously.
Yeah.
But his is so intense, and then the dealing with the fact that his dad left him to be by his mom's bedside when she's dying, and then he's got to wind up, he's at his dad's, and he's just saying like, I hate you, and like, it is intense. But that song, man, when they're all breaking down, and
really
just,
good one, so.
You just don't expect it. They all start singing, and in a moment where you think this might seem goofy, that they all just start singing, it works.
It works. You know, it works so well. Yeah, I remember. Did I see it with you in the theater? I don't know.
Oh,
I definitely saw it in the theater because when the frogs came down, I was like, "What is going on?" But then, you know, you get into it, and it sucks you right in. And then when it gets to that part, it should be a cheese ball moment, and you're just like, "No," like it hits you hard.
Yeah,
and it works. It really, really. That song really, really. Obviously, the song really works, but that moment really works. And she does the whole script, the whole soundtrack, right? So
So if you get like, I own that Magnolia soundtrack. Mostly, it's her, singing.
Yeah,
Save Me, I think, is one off of it, or something like that. And that's the big one at the end, I think. But anyways, so that's my number one. That was like pretty much a no-brainer for me. And I got to say, for an episode that I was a little hesitant on, I really enjoyed hearing everybody's needle drops here. So
yeah,
it was great.
Yeah. It's obviously it's a very personal thing too, right? Like the what songs connect with you with certain scenes. And so I love it. Like it definitely, I got the inspiration. I actually got the inspiration, aka stole the inspiration from a podcast that why am I blanking on that? One guy's name's Olson, but it's I'm blanking. Gremlins director.
Joe Dante.
Joe Dante does this podcast with this other guy, Josh Olson.
I love that you remember the Olson guy's name.
Yeah. Because the whole thing, I was focusing so hard on trying to remember Josh Olson's name that I forgot him. So they did a podcast, and they did an episode about needle drops. And so they did their favorites. And so I stole the idea from them, but I was like, oh man, because they're rhyming off theirs. And I'm like, oh, that's good. That's good. Oh, that's good. And I started thinking about my own. So then I'm like, we got to do that. So
yeah,
glad you guys liked it.
So that's our list.
Want to know yours.
We want to know yours. Write it in the comments here.
Cause we know that there's a ton that we didn't use that you love. So
Scott, give us your 10 honorable mentions.
No.
I'm going to do it on the screen. I got to get out of here.
Put them in the comments.
Put them in the comments. Yeah, yes, that's right. Yeah.
Okay. Also, see you later, Tom Hacker. See you later, LB.
take the quickie quiz. That'll be on later today. Like, share, and subscribe. Share your list in the comments. We'll be back in a couple of weeks with the second part of our musical thing here with our B-side, where we're going to talk about movie soundtracks. that are better than the movie itself. Okay, we'll see you later.